Everything has come in better than even I had thought. Earnings are coming in better than I had thought. That retail number was eye-popping. Fourth quarter earning numbers were actually very good. I'm writing a letter right now for our first quarter, and it's all about what happened in the fourth quarter. And operating income for reopening stocks was up, in many cases, 20-25% from pre-COVID levels. So we're getting excellent fundamentals right now, which had not been baked in. During COVID, companies took a lot of costs out, and that's coming in with a positive surprise.
Mike, I guess the sort of head-scratcher of the week, though it's a good thing for markets, is that yields have pulled back despite all this great data. To what extent do we think that's because it's being anchored by international yields and therefore perhaps is hiding what might kind of come and catch us later in the year if inflation does pick up a bit more?
Well, I think there's a lot of ways to slice it. One is just a flow picture, and that there have been enough global flows to capture what yield advantage U.S. Bonds have. There was very heavy positioning against bonds. Remember, bonds had their worst quarter in many years in terms of total return in the first quarter. So people were underinvested. And arguably, the run from 0.5% on the 10-year up to 1.75 was exactly discounting this great stretch of economic data that we're now seeing in front of us. So I think there's a little bit of a lead and lag factor going on as well. And you know, it has taken the market a while to come to terms with the fact that this is not necessarily going to push us into a Fed tightening cycle very quickly. So that kind of gets manifested through some of the crowded trades, like the steepening trade in the yield curve for Treasuries.
Archegos Capital Management setting off a storm in markets last month when it and a number of banks began selling out of highly leveraged positions in U.S. legacy media companies Discovery and Viacom CBS, along with Chinese companies like Baidu and Tencent Music. Big banks like Credit Suisse, Nomura and Morgan Stanley took financial hits from the debacle, as we discussed earlier. Morgan Stanley surprising the market somewhat with a close to $1 billion loss, though smaller than Credit Suisse and Nomura. Charlie, got to get your take on this. I think, you know, the last time we had you on this show in particular was, you know, just after the sell-off had happened, I guess, but perhaps before all the kind of stories had come out. I mean, what's your take as we sit here today, and firstly on where Viacom CBS trades now, if you've gone back into the stock, and exactly how it played out and which banks played which roles?
Yeah, I think the story here is that the stock has just been in unstable hands for the last month or so. And people like me who loved it, people like Mario Gabelli who loved it, owned it at 20 and 30 and 40 and 50, and then all got out. Most of us got almost all the way out in the 90s or 80s. And so then they did the offering. And as you guys, we've talked about, when somebody does a convertible bond offering, simultaneously, those buyers often short the stock. Then there were those big block trades, which tend to be institutional short-term money. So the stock is just not in natural long-term hands right now. Last time I was on, I think the stock was 72, and we said it was still above our calculation of intrinsic value. At 39, I can tell you it's now below our calculation of intrinsic value. We have a value in the 50s. So we want to be careful and wait till this settles down. But at this point, it's an attractive stock.
Shepard Smith here. Thanks for watching CNBC on YouTube.